very thankful for the love of God. Amen. Why don't you get stand on your feet and give the Lord your name at the place? Come on, I believe he deserves just a good praise tonight. Don't need no music to praise him. Don't need nobody to help me up to praise him. We'll praise him for his goodness tonight. Praise him for his love tonight. Praise him because he loved me. Hallelujah. Amen. Looked upon you and saw something good in you. Ain't that good? Amen. God is good. God is good. And he is greatly to be praised. Amen. Okay, let me go to prayer list right real quick. We'll go to the Lord in prayer tonight. We got Betty Dyke on the prayer list. Also, Maxine Bishop. Got a spoken request. Jerry Lee. Got Adam, Nathan, Frankie Bradford. Frank Bradford's on here also. Got Peggy, Kevin, Mike, and family. And we got Deanna with an unspoken request tonight. Anybody else got prayer with us right quick? Yes. Right here? Okay. Anybody else right quick before we pray? Anybody? Where we at? I missed somebody. Here we go. I'm sorry about the wait. Who's that now? Thomas. Okay. I see another hand. What was it at? Somebody else got prayer with me? Okay. All right. How many of you got somebody lost in your family? Okay. How many of you know somebody that needs to be saved? How many of you need to move God in your life? How many of you need God to move in a special area?
Amen.
Amen. How many of you got something to praise him for? Amen. Okay. So we all have petitions. We all have people that need to be saved. And we all got something to praise him about. So bring your praise. Bring your petition, bring your burden, and let's bring it to the altar tonight. Come on, let's go. Come on. Come on, let's get with you. Come on. Amen. No place better to gather than around the altar of God. Amen, preacher. That's good. Okay. Amen. Come on. Come on, let's gather in here and let's just bring these things before the Lord. Every care, cast them all upon him tonight. God is able, folks. You know that? God is able. Able to meet the need of your life. Able to meet any need that's in this building. God is able. He's very able. Father, again, we want to thank you for the privilege we have this evening to be able to come before the throne of God tonight. And to come once again in Jesus' name tonight. Coming tonight knowing that as we come on the merits of who the Lord is tonight. Knowing that Jesus is in the presence of God for each one of us tonight. We know, Lord, that your word says that he's there tonight as our advocate. He's there as our mediator. Scripture says he's ever living to intercede for us tonight. There is our high priest, as one that can be touched with the feelings of our infirmities. And I am so thankful and grateful tonight to know that we have representation there tonight. To know that Jesus is there. And Lord, I'm so thankful and grateful for that tonight. To know that we have someone there in the presence of God for us. And we give you praise tonight. We do. Thankful again for the privilege we have to be able to gather tonight in this house with people of like precious faith. I'm thankful that we can come together in a midweek service and we can come together to worship the living God. We can come together to exalt his name. We can come together to magnify his name tonight. We can come together tonight testify the goodness of God. We come together tonight to get strength with one another, to fellowship with one another, and most of all to magnify the name of the Lord tonight. And we're thankfully grateful that we do have a place we can gather. We're thankful tonight that we have a place we can come together to exalt his name and to worship his name and to be able, Lord, to expound on your word. And trusting tonight, Father, as the word goes out, that it will go out with the anointing that it carries. And it will go out with the spirit of understanding tonight. I pray that when it's all said and done, that the word will have brought understanding to our lives and we can leave tonight better than when we came. We can leave tonight better equipped than when we came. We can leave tonight being able better to stand in the face of every adversity and then stand in the face of every circumstance that everyone is looking at. And Father, I just pray tonight you will help us to heed the word of God and to hear it with clarity. and become a doer of it, and obey the word of God and in act of obedience, Lord. I pray for every individual. I pray that every ear will be opened up. I pray that every heart will be receptive tonight to the word of God as you speak and as you begin to reveal to the church what the Spirit is saying to us tonight in this hour. So I pray you'll speak tonight, Holy Spirit. We need you to come and begin to move and dwell and begin to do what only you can do in this house tonight. You're the miracle worker tonight. You're our helper, so we need you. Can't do anything in this room tonight without you. Holy Ghost, we need you in all of your power tonight. We need you in every aspect of this meeting tonight. We need you to come and to breathe upon us and to make your presence known here tonight. And I just pray that you will help us as we enter into this meeting tonight. Like, Lord, it may be our last meeting this side of heaven. It may be the last time we'll ever gather this side of heaven. It may be the last opportunity we ever have, Lord, just to say amen, just to exalt your name. Maybe the last opportunity we'll ever have to stand and give a testimony of how good God is and how good he's been to us. Could be the last opportunity we'll ever have this side of heaven as we leave this meeting tonight. I pray that before we leave, we'll know that we have been obedient to God. We've been obedient to your word. And I pray that you will help us to hearken to the voice of the Lord here tonight in this house, Lord. I pray for every need in this room, every prayer request that was made mention tonight, every unspoken request, God, we pray and plead the blood over. Every unsaved family member represented by these homes tonight, we plead the blood over. We're believing for salvation to come to our homes. We're believing for our children to be saved and husbands to be saved and grandmas and grandpas to come out of darkness. And I'm just believing, Lord, for families to be touched by the power of God, for families to be redeemed and for the sick to be healed. I'm just believing, Lord, in this hour that you'll just open the windows of heaven up and begin to pour out your blessing upon your people. I believe tonight, Lord, that in this hour that we're living in, I believe we're living in an hour when you're longing to pour out your presence and your power. I believe we're living in an hour, Lord, when you're wanting to open the windows of heaven up and begin to manifest your power and begin to reveal who you are in the lives of your people. And I pray that you will help us here in this house and in this church, Father, that we can be a people that will be about the Father's business. We'll be a people that will turn an ear to God, a people that will open their hearts up to the Spirit of God and allow the Holy Ghost to move and allow you to have liberty in our lives. And I pray that we will be a people that will be hungry in this hour, a people that will open their hearts up, and a people that will cry to God, a people that will weep from the altar to the porch, Lord. I pray you'll help us to bring back those days where we long for the Spirit of God, where we long for the presence of God, where we desire you more than we desire our next meal. I pray you will come and breathe upon this house and breathe upon these people, that in these last days that you will pour out your Spirit upon all flesh. And Father, our families will be touched and homes will be changed and marriages will be reconciled. And I'm just believing, Lord, that a great move of God is going to come and saturate this land, for you gave us the formula in your word. You said, if my people which are called by my name shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face, then you will hear from heaven and you will forgive our sin and you will heal our land. God, if there's ever an hour we need in our land healed, we need our land healed. We need our community healed. If there's ever a time we ever needed the windows of God to open up and the river of God to open up, it's this hour that we're in right now. If we ever needed a move of God, we need a move of God now. We have people dying all around us in this community, Father. We have drug addicts that are dying right now. People that are wanting to be delivered from drugs. And I know only one way they can do that, and that is through the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's through the power of the miracle worker himself. That's through the power and the anointing of the Holy Ghost to come and to set people free. People that long to be free. I believe you're longing to set them free. I believe you're more eager to give than we are to ask. And I'm praying, oh God, that you will help us to hear from heaven and help us to do whatever it is we need to do in order to usher in this last move of God, in order to usher in this last great revival. And I believe you're going to sweep this world with. I believe it, Lord, and I pray that you will help us as a people of God to get our hearts right and to get our minds set on the things of God and get our ears open to what thus saith the Lord. So come tonight, Holy Ghost, and help us here in this meeting tonight. We need you desperately, we do. So come, we invite you to come. We need you to come, we do. We can't do anything here tonight without you. I know it's a midweek service. I know folk don't want to come to the old dead, dried up Wednesday night meeting, but I tell you, Lord, I'm thankful to God I can be here. I'm thankful to God I'm in my right mind tonight. I'm thankful to God I have health in my body. I've been redeemed from the curse of the law. Thank God I've been redeemed from sickness and disease, and I can shout the praises of God because I'm in a sound mind and have health in my body. I can walk around tonight and know that I have liberty to come and go as I please, because I know it's all because of you. I pray you'll help us here tonight. Help us to hear your voice and be obedient to the call of God. And you know what you say tonight in this house? We invite you to come. We do. Breathe upon everything that is said and done here tonight, that Jesus Christ can be glorified. That's the only reason we're here. That's the only reason these lights are on tonight, is that Jesus can be magnified and he can be edified tonight in this house. So I pray you'll come, Holy Ghost, and help us to be able to do that here tonight. And we'll give you praise. And we'll give you glory for everything that's accomplished now in this house. We'll give you praise. For we ask it in Jesus' mighty, mighty name. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Blessed be the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. God good. God good. And his spirit's real.
Amen.
Holy Ghost is real.
Amen.
Hallelujah. What will we do without our helper? Woo! What will we do without our comforter?
That's right.
Ain't nobody can comfort you like the Holy Ghost can comfort you. Nobody. Nobody. Nobody can feel you like he feels you. Nobody. Nobody can love you like he loves you. Nobody. Hallelujah. I tell you what makes me about the
Holy Spirit. What Jesus could not do with his disciples in 3.5 years. About 30 seconds in the upper room, he did. Hallelujah. What he could do for Peter, I tell you, 30 seconds with the Holy Ghost turned Peter to a mighty flame of God. Turned those 12 men, those 120 in the upper room, into a flame of God. They couldn't contain it in the upper room and spill out on the streets. Those that went outside looking in said, what meaneth it? Well, those men are drunk. I mean, here it is at 9 o'clock in the morning. They already drunk on wine, on new wine. They were drunk on wine, new wine. They were. This is that, Peter said. This is that which Peter, which Joel prophesied. And he prophesied in the last days, God said, I shall pour out of my spirit upon all flesh. And thank God, those began the last days on the day of Pentecost. And we are in the last of the last days now. And the Holy Ghost has not grown weaker. We've grown duller hearing, but he's not grown weaker. And God is still longing to pour out his presence and power upon his people. And all that power is still available today. Holy Ghost is still available today. The gifts of the Spirit are still available today. Now, we may shut them down, but God hasn't shut them down. The gifts are still available for the people of God that want the gifts of the Spirit to operate in their house and in their lives is still available. The gifts are only given upon desire. If you'll desire them and you'll seek after them, I believe God Almighty will still give them. I believe that. I believe that. The reason we don't see them operating is because nobody desires them anymore. We're content to come and to our little Sunday morning service or our midweek service, and we're content to get whatever we can get and walk out the same way we come in without ever being changed. But I'll tell you, there's a day coming, I believe we're in that day right now, an hour right now, when people will come in the house of God and read differently than when they came in. I believe God is looking for a people that will gather together and let him be who he said he was. Let him be Jehovah God. Let him be the healer of our bodies. Let him be the ruler of our hearts and life. And let him be only who only he can be. He is. He is the only God. He needs no help. He is God all by himself. That's why they call him Jehovah. Because there ain't none like him in all the earth. Moses said, there ain't none like you, Lord. You're marvelous in holiness and you're doing wonders. And you know what I believe? I believe he deserves a good hand clap of praise and a shout of praise right now in this spirit. Because of who he is. Hallelujah. He's God all by himself. He got me out of where I used to be and brought me to where I am right now. He's hallelujah. I'll be what I want to be, but thank God I'm not who I used to be, glory to God. I'm not who I used to be. Glory to God. Hallelujah. I want all to heal. All to heal. All to heal. Hallelujah. Praise God. That'll stir you up. Hallelujah. I feel stirred up tonight. Glory to God. God good. Anybody got a testimony? Anybody got a praise report? Anybody got a praise report? Praise report. Come on, somebody. Hurry up. Come on, Juanita.
I do.
Good.
I want to give God all the glory, Pastor, because I'm telling you, Sunday, when they were playing that song about the healing, his word that he was saying, I am telling you, that got so deep down in my spirit.
Oh, yeah.
And I thought the Holy Ghost speaks to me and say, you will praise me like you mean that. Yes. Because I've been having trouble on my hip arthritis and my neck. And I'm telling you, God healed me.
Hey, I heard that grumble. Amen. Thank God. You know what amazed me about that? Nobody had to pray for you. Nobody had to know you at all. Nobody had to make God do this. He said, you praise me and I'll heal you. You will be obedient to what God said. Went up there, I seen you right to the right side of me. And I seen you praising God like you never praised him before. And you raised them hands up. And when you began to worship him, he began to do what he said he would do. He met you at your knee. He healed your body, Lord. And I said, he healed your body. He healed your body. He healed your body. Glory to God. That's what he said he knew. Amen. That's what happens when you get around wars. Don't need nobody pray for them. Get it yourself. Hallelujah. That's where y'all act like y'all scared death of us tonight. What's the matter with y'all? Somebody else got to pray for them. Come on, somebody else. Come on, hurry. Come on, nobody know. Come on, talk to me, somebody. Hurry up. Okay. Father, will you bless our people here, please? I ask you to open the windows up between now and Sunday. Bless them to where they come back Wednesday night. But they can't contain themselves because of the blessing that you poured up on them. I pray that upon them tonight, Lord. Pour on things. Say, I'm glad they blessed on them. Pour on things. They've been blessed on them. Hallelujah. How many of you feel like you got a sound mind? Some of y'all ain't laying your hands up. Clarence looked at Joe and said, don't you raise your hand up. Amen. You got to say, what? Well, you better hurry up because I'm getting ready to turn this thing around, buddy.
Today's my mom's birthday. Yeah. And this is the first birthday that we've had since she passed. And last night, when I was sitting at the whole week leading up to it, I've been really, thinking about her a lot. More than normal, and last night I was really getting to him, and I was crying with him. And just all at once, the Holy Spirit comes to me, and he said, this is not her birthday. Her birthday was September 11th, the day I called her home. And he said, can you imagine the jubilee that went on when she showed up? And I mean, he just took every bit of that hurt and pain that I had in me away, the sadness away. It just changed.
He is our comforter. Yes, hallelujah.
More than words can explain.
It's just
been great.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. Last Wednesday night when we talked about they overcame him by the
word of the
Lamb.
Word of the
Lamb. Word of their I just Okay. Anybody else got a praise report right quick? Praise report only. Don't want no well, praise report. You got a praise report? Herbie, you ready?
Ready.
Come on, man. Come on. We won't drag it out. Come on. Your chance to get away this way. We flew him all the way in with him. Any creek, you come. Wide open. Amen. We're going to fly back.
Children's church.
Man, I'm all called up here. Let's go downstairs. Who's going downstairs? Let's go. I've got all that. Let's go.
You done. You done preaching this. I said, you done the preaching. Amen. I tell you, he's done got me excited tonight. I don't know about y'all. You know, I'm nervous and excited all the same, and I'm just like a pressure cooker. And I believe that I'm well overcooked because I've thought this thing through. And all I can say is I'm going to let the Word speak it tonight. And I'm going to let the Word preach it tonight. But I'm just so excited to be here. And I can tell you what, God gave me a Word. And I know when I begin to look back over my notes and I said, did I put that on here? Are you kidding me? But I can tell you this right now. I give all God the glory. And I know if I give God the glory, that he'll get what needs to come out of this. And I know God gave me a word early in the year. It was sometime after the fast. And he began to speak something to me and began to bring a story that we look at as in the past over 2,000 years ago. We look at it as a story, but it is a now thing. And it excited me, and I can tell you what, it began to preach to me. But I just want to lay a foundation this evening and just begin to take my time and just begin to bring this word, because this is so important for me that y'all will get this, that this will come out as clear as it come to me. Because it is very important for me, Pastor, because God began to speak this to me. And I said, if I can just get this, to what God, this word is for me, by the way. Some of this, you know, God gave me one scripture. One scripture. It's a scripture that we all, most of us know. If you've been in this house and you've been in the Word, and if not, then that's all right, because you're going to hear it tonight. But he gave me one scripture, and God gave it to me, and it was up on top of the hill on the welding yard. But I want to just lay a foundation before I get to that and just begin to show you some things. John 16 and 33, it says, "These things I have spoken to you, that in me you may have peace." Amen. In the world you may have tribulations, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. Amen. We know that we have tribulations. And I begin to look at tribulations as pressure and trouble and suffering. God tells us that we're going to have those things. So we're going to have them, Pastor. 2 Timothy 3 and 12. It says, "Yes, all who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus will suffer persecution." Persecution, it means hostility or being mistreated, Pastor. It means you're going to go through some offenses. It means in this life that you're going to go through some things that you don't want to go through. And I can tell you what, if you're in a workplace and you work, or if you go out and do God's business, you're going to get offended. And offense is going to come to you. But God says that His Word, that this is going to happen. It must happen. Pastor, so just begin to soak this through. Just begin to let it be clear. Philippians 2, 14 through 16. "Do all things without complaining and disputing, that you may have become blameless and harmless children of God without fault in the midst of a crooked and perverse generations, among whom you may shine as lights in the world, holding fast to the word of life." The word of life. This right here is the word of life. Holding fast to this word. This word is everything, Pastor, that I know. It's everything, Pastor. What he opened up to me is right here. He began to open up to me something, and I pray to God that it will come out tonight. "Holding fast to the word of life, so that I may rejoice in the day of Christ, that I have made run in vain," or labored in vain, "that I have made naught." If I don't do this, then I have done everything in vain. I have labored everything that I've done in vain if I don't follow this. On, if I don't follow this word, if this word doesn't speak to me, then I have done everything in vain. Yeah. Pastor, I don't want to make a joke, but I heard somebody say, "Why are you so loud for? Why are you so mad?" You remember that? Clarence, he says, "That's just the way God made me." I know I'm not usually loud, but I can tell you what, I'm excited for what God's going to do and what God's already spoke to me in my life this year, Pastor. I was going through some things, but I thank God for my tribulations. I thank God for what Paul says. I thank Him for it, because that's where I grow. You know, I love being on the mountain. I love being on a mountaintop up there in the Weld Yard. God shows me some things. I love that mountaintop. But I can tell you what, when I get out of the valleys, oh my God, it sticks with me. It's changed my life. I can tell you what, this word has changed my life this year. What would I be without Jesus? Remember that word. What Pastor says, I don't know what my name was before. I know Herb is not the best name, but I can tell you what, that's what God gave me. And I can tell you what, these things we got to go through, tribulations, persecution, and all that, Pastor, we got to do without complaining.
Yeah.
We got to do all this without murmuring and complaining And you know, it's tough enough to go through these things, but now, Chad, I gotta go without art, you know. It's hard sometimes. It's hard sometimes when you're on a job that very few people believe in Christ. It's hard sometimes when you're around people, all you hear is nothing but blankety blank. Sometimes it's hard. Sometimes you gotta go through these things. My God, let me show you what he showed. I'm going to do a flip around. Y'all going to think, my goodness, where is he going? Where is he going with this at? Because you're going to know this scripture so well. And sometimes I might, who knows where I go with these notes. But I know God's in control. Joshua 5:13. And it came to pass when Joshua was by Jericho. And then he lifted his eyes up and he looked. And behold, a man opposite of him with a sword drawn in his hand. And Joshua went to him and said to him, are you for us or are you against us? Next picture. Joshua. Ain't that neat, by the way? Thank the Lord for that picture. I was trying to figure it out a while, but Joshua drew near Jericho. And when I think of Jericho, I think of the wall, Pastor. And this is where I'm going to begin. This is the scripture that God gave me. He says, Joshua, when he drew near the wall. Why did he draw near the wall, Pastor? He began to speak to me up on the welding yard because I began to feel this heaviness and this burden upon me. And I sat in my welding truck, and I wasn't sure if I was going to tell this story or not, but here it is. I sat in my welding truck, and I just sat there, and I said, my God, what is this? What is this? I couldn't figure it out, and I turned on my radio, started listening to some praise and worship music. Then I started listening to some word, and it just wasn't doing it. I said, God, show me what this is. He says, you remember? Do you remember? During the fast, you prayed, search me. Search my heart, search my ways. Know me, God, know every weak thing in me. He says, you remember that? I said, yeah, I remember that. And Pastor, I had to get out of my welding truck. I had to get out of that welding truck and I began to walk around. And I tell you, I don't know if anybody seen me or not, but I think I was up there by myself. And I began to walk around and I began to just meditate upon God. I said, God, what are you saying? What are you giving me scripture? Because he gave me this scripture clear as you can get. And that's never happened hardly to me before like that. Well, I said, what is it? I know Joshua was by the wall. He drew near Jericho for a reason. And that Lord, that he lifted his eyes up and he looked and he saw that man with that sword. I know that, God. He said, do you know the next verse? I said, I do. I know in verse 14, if you got it, it says, and he said, nay, but as captain of the host of the Lord, I have now come. And Joshua fell on his face to the earth and did worship to the earth and said to him, what saith the Lord to his servant? There stood a man opposite of him. And he says, if you know the word, listen to this clearly, people. He says, if you know the word, and you know who the next verse was, because most of us know that, and know some people might not. He says, if you know the word, then why are you saying the same thing? Listen to me, people. Listen. Listen, don't let this confuse you, because I'm going to leave this, and I'm going to go to some places. He said, why are you saying, are you for me? Or are you for us or are you for your adversaries? I said, Joshua was just asking a statement. He was asking a statement because he didn't know who was there. I can understand that. But we're going to dig into that more. He says, but why are you knowing the word as if you're saying the same things? Oh, boy. I began to stomp my feet, Pastor. I'm telling you the truth. I began to stomp my foot like this right here.
because it started burning up inside of me, and I just couldn't help it. I began to stomp. I said, "My God, I know what you're saying. You searched me, God, you did. And I know, you know," and it began to bring me to some things, and I began to dig stuff up. And I'm going to leave this for a little bit. But let me ask you this. Do you think Joshua would have said that if he knew who was standing there? The commander of the Lord of the army? Do you think that he would have said, "Are you for us or for you, or are you against us?" No way. No way, because the scripture said that he fell down on his face and worshipped him. There's no way that he would have done it if he knew exactly who was standing there. Pastor, I'm not here to say who the commander of the Lord, but I know in the beginning was the Word. And I know the sword is sharper than two, any edged sword. Whether it being the Word or whether it being 2 Timothy 3:16, the Holy Scriptures, the Bible right here, covers it all, what we need to do. And it's in very detail, Pastor, and most of us here know exactly. I don't have to preach to you that we have to go through tribulation, and I know that we do. I don't have to preach on you that we have to go through all these things because we've heard them. But who are we speaking to when I don't do them? When I don't do them, who am I? What am I saying? It's as if I'm saying, "My God, let this speak to you. Let this word speak to you. Who is it when I don't obey his word?" See, I give Satan so much credit sometimes. Because, Pastor, this word, if I leave it, Satan has nothing on me. He has no power over my life. I wish I could get this out that he showed me. Maybe I can't. But I can tell you what God has opened up in my mind is endless. Pastor, if I obey this word and I do what it says, Satan has nothing on me. He has no power on me. Oh, my goodness. Let me talk to you. The real question, here's the statement. Put the one with the real question on there. I might have skipped that one. The real question is, what is my intent when I say the very same things, but in other words or actions? And I'm going to go tell you, this is the title of it, and I probably done said it. The next thing, are you for me or are you against me? What do you mean? This is what I'm going to tell you. The Lord began to speak to me. Is the next statement on earth says, it means when all I see is what's keeping me from God's promise. It's all I see when it keeps me from God's promise, because Joshua was uncertain who was standing there. When I see the wall, and I see what's keeping me from God's promise. What promise are you talking about? I'm talking about you lost ones saved. I'm talking about salvation. I'm talking about stuff that we've been so excited about, Juanita, and we've seen so clearly. We've been on the mountaintop and seen stuff so clearly. We've seen these people saved in our minds. We've seen our kids saved. You begin to speak to me and you come to my mind. Ooh, mercy. I'm going to save the best to last. Juanita, there's some promises that God has spoken. Some unconditionally and some conditionally, but it's in the Word. We can have it. Amen. Whether it be our kids, whether it be a healing, whatever it is in your life that you want that promise. It's that promise that I'm talking about. When you come to the place where all you see is the wall in your life. Church, it's going to happen. It's happened to me, and I know it's going to happen to you. It's a statement of being hurt or offended. How many times have we been hurt or offended in our lives? How many times when you know that your brother or sister should have done this or that, and you begin to say, Lord, they shouldn't have done that. They hurt me, God. They offended me. What about that time? Are you for me or are you against me? Sometimes you think, my God, why did they do that? Brother Mike, are you for me or against me? You've been hurt, you've been offended, and everybody here has done it. And everybody here has been hurt and offended. I know I have, Brother Adam, I know that we all have at a time or two. But the way we should handle it is whether or not we say, are you for me or against me?
Amen.
But who are you really asking it to? Is it the person or is it the word? Who is it? I didn't cover the statement of offense. We're all going to go through our offenses. I'm going to go into some word here. Luke 17:1. And I'm going to end up back at the wild with Joshua. But I'm going to leave that alone for a minute. And just begin to dig into some word here. He said, then he said to the disciples, it is impossible that no offense should come. But woe to the hen through whom they do come. Woe to him who do come. I won't get into a story that the Lord had showed me and just begin to dig some of this up, because it does no good if I don't show you nothing in the Word. It does you no good for me to speak. Pastor taught me that. 2 Samuel 16:5-12. Is it up there? Yes, amen. Just give me a little time. Now when the King David had come to Bahurim, forgive me on some of these words, there was a man from the family of the house of Saul, whose name was Shimei, the son of Gerar. Coming from there, he came out cursing continuously as he came. And he threw stones at David and all the servants of the kings and all the people of the almighty men were on his right hand and on his left. Also Shimei said thus, when he cursed, come out, you bloodthirsty man, you rogue. The Lord has brought upon you the blood of the house of the Saul, in whose place have you reigned, and the Lord has delivered the kingdom into the hand of Absalom, your son. So now you are caught in your own evil, because you are a bloodthirsty man. Then Abishai, the son of Zeruiah, said to the king, why should this dead dog curse me, the Lord King? Please let me go over and take off his head. But the king says, what have I to do with you, you sons of Zeruiah? So let him curse, because the Lord has said to him, curse David. Can you hear that? Do you hear that? Let the Lord say to him, curse David. That don't sound like something the Lord would say. Who then shall say, why have you done so? And David said that Abishai and sons of servants, so how my sons came from my own body, six life. How much more does this Benjamite? Let him alone. Let him curse, for the Son of the Lord has ordered him. It may be that the Lord will look upon my affliction, and that the Lord will repay me for good for this cursing this day. How many times have you been cursed? And have you noticed that this man named Shemaiah, I don't know these names, somehow, I had to look them up. But he brought up everything. Pastor, he brought up his past. He brought up Uriah that he had murdered. Called him a bloodthirsty man, and David knew it was true. Then he began to put him down as like his son would then overtook Absalom, then his son done forsake him, trying to take over the kingdom. That's just like the enemy trying to bring up the past to try to make you mad. And boy, does he work. Huh? Satan's smarter than we think, but he has no power. But he uses things. Me and Brian was talking about what things Satan uses on us.
Amen.
And this is one very good thing. Satan begins to bring up stuff. He knows the word better than we do. if I could just bring his past up, he'll have a reason to get mad. He had people there to take him, to take that man down, could have done away with him. But David said, let him curse. Because maybe I deserve it. Or maybe is this just a story, Pastor? Maybe is this just something that David said, and it might not be in a word. Maybe I need some more, and the Lord began to show me of some more word in Ecclesiastes 7, 21 and 22. It said, also do not take heart in everything people say, lest you hear your servant cursing you. Mm-mm-mm. Don't take heart in everything people say. Boy, it's hard to do. For many times also your own heart has known that you even curse to others. Ooh, not me. Not me. I've never talked about nobody. I tell you, you'll get your feelings hurt quick.
Amen.
Because it's happened to me before on the job, and you know yourself in your heart that you've done the same very things. And when it comes out, you go, man, I've done nothing but good to this person. I've done nothing but good to these people. I cannot believe they talked about me like that. It hurts. And all you want to do is offend yourself. But who are we offending when we go against the word? Is it the wild or is it the man? Is it the commander of the Lord? God began to show me something. He says, leave Satan out of this. He said, this is between me and you. He says, who am I offending?
Wow.
You're not offending Satan. You're not offending that person.
Right.
He says, when you realize, Herbie, when you realize this word is going to work for you, he said, I'm going to open some things up. And he says, you tell that church, when you realize what this word will do, because we all know here what we're supposed to do. He says, but when we realize who we're talking to, when we realize who we're saying, are you for me or are you against me? We know that God's for us and he's not against us.
Amen.
Proverbs 17:9, he says, who recovers transgression seeks love. But he who repeats a matter separates very friends. Right there. Transgressions means offenses. He says when we do the same thing that we'll begin to separate our friends.
Amen.
You know, I ain't got this in the notes, but Pastor, I begin to read about Moses a little bit. And in Numbers 12, if you want to read it, the word says that Moses was offended. But he was offended by his own brother and sister. Very good story, and I pray that you read it. It says that Aaron and Miriam went to him and says, has not the Lord spoke to us? Has he not spoke to us too, Moses? And they come against him because, the word said, because of his wife. They begin to give him a hard time. Has the Lord not spoke to us too, Moses? His own brother and sister. You know, the word says that he was a very humble man, most of all the earth. Can you picture Moses begin to get talked to his brother and sister? And Pastor, I could just see him just sitting there taking it. And I could see that he was getting hurt. And I could just see all this and I could just see him just taking it in. My God, you know, I've done being offended by the Israelites. Now my brothers and sisters are coming against me. And the word says that the Lord heard. Remember the verse says, woe to the people that offend you. It don't mean just the enemies. It could mean your brother or sister. He'll deal with them. He says, Lord told you, he said, all three of you come out of that tabernacle. And when they all three came out, it said that a pillar of cloud came down and he stood in the midst. And he began to speak to Aaron and Miriam, something that'll set fear into you. He said, who is it? He said, he begins to talk about a prophet. He said, don't I talk to a prophet in a vision and into a dream? He says, not Moses. Not Moses. Moses, I talked to him face to face. Face to face, Pastor. And I begin to think, Pastor, sometimes you say you don't get the visions and dreams. Maybe it is that you stay in the Word and you talk face to face. My God. He said, and he talks face to face. He said, why wasn't you fearful about talking about him? How come you weren't so fearful when you began to speak? I bet you they was after that. I bet you they was after that. And the Lord began to show me how Moses reacted. And Matthew 5:5 come to me, I just searched, and it says, blessed are the meek, for they inherit the earth. And he began to show meek. You know, we begin to look at meek as a weak word. Meek means strength brought under control. And the Greek term means a wild horse tamed to the bridle. Oh, look at his meekness. If they can only see a wild horse tamed under a bridle, how much power that is. When we sit back and we're humble and meek, it's just like that wild horse that has been trained. But when Jesus begins to bridle you and begins to grab those and begin to control you, what power they are. Power in the Word. Who could be against you? Amen. You see where I'm at here. Psalms. It's right here. Come to me in Psalms 37:1-9. Do not fret because of evildoers, nor be envious of workers of iniquity. For their shoots shall be cut down like the grass, and wither like the green herb. Trust in the Lord and do good. Dwell in the land and feed on His faithfulness. Delight yourself also in the Lord, and He shall give you the desires of your heart. Commit your ways to the Lord. Trust also in Him, and He shall bring the past. He shall bring forth the righteousness as light, and your justice in the noonday. Rest in the Lord and wait patiently for Him. Do not fret because of him who prospers in his ways, because of the man who brings wicked schemes to pass. Cease from anger and forsake wrath. Do not fret, it only causes harm. For evildoers shall be cut off, but those who wait upon the Lord, my goodness, they shall inherit the earth. Can you see that? That's a poem that comes from David. Can you see one of those rangers being just trained up? Brother Adam, they could go out anytime and kill any person they want, but they won't do nothing unless their commander tells them. It's power. Power in the Word when we begin to obey it. The man at the pool of Bathsheba, Lord, just begin to show me John 5:1-7. He said, after this there was a feast of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now there is in Jerusalem by the sheep gate a pool, which is called in Hebrew Bathsheba, having 5 porches, and these a great multitude of sick people, blind, lame, paralyzed, waiting for the moving of the water. For an angel went down to a certain time into the pool and stirred up the water. Then whoever stepped in at first after the stirring of the water was made well after the disease he had. Now a certain man was there who had an infirmity 38 years. When Jesus saw him lying there, he knew that he had already been in the condition a long time. He said to him, do you want to be made well? The sick man answered to him, sir, I have no man to put me into the pool of the water. It's stirred up, but while I'm waiting, coming, another one steps down before me. If this man only knew who was speaking to me. If he only knew. I begin to think about this man. Pastor, you know, here's levels, and I begin to try to get a visual of how this was. But I could see this man coming in, and those sick people all gathered around. And when he first come in, maybe one of the porches furthest away, and started working his way to it. Mm-hmm. I can see those people helping him. Come on, brother. Let's get healed. Let's get healed. And they begin to help him every step of the way. And every time they get closer, he'd find new friends. You know, people would come and go, but there was always somebody there for him to help him. And as he got closer and closer to the pool, I believe he got to the last step. But guess what? It was time for the other people's healing. It was time for their healing. They had waited long enough. We got to get our healing. And they forgot about him. The very ones that was with him, the whole step of the way, they forgot about this man. I believe that's the way it happened. Because you get a bunch of sick people together, they want to help each other. But they forgot about him. And he got his eyes off of the healing. He got his eyes on the problem. He got his eyes on not being able to get up and get into the pool in time. He got his eyes off of it. And he began to think about, if I could only find somebody to help me. If I could only find somebody to pick me up and put me into the pool. But there came a man that began to speak, do you want to be made well? Then he began to say, are you for me or are you against me, man? Can't you see I can't get up? I can't make it.
Amen.
Come on, man.
Yeah.
Help me out. Brother Mike, I can remember you said, help me out, man. You was begging for somebody to help you out. But maybe it was meant in hope too. Maybe it was meant for you to get your eyes on Jesus. Because my God, what a change he's put in y'all's life. I'm telling you, church, sometimes we go through things and it's hard to not get our eyes on the problem. But God brings us a word. He brings us a word to renew us, to get our eyes back on Jesus. To get our eyes back on what the Word says. It's right here. We got to believe it. I believe this man didn't mean to make an offense. I don't believe he did. But I believe all we could see was the problem. What was the next statement up there? All we know is why we're not healed. And not why, not what the Word says. We always know why we shouldn't be healed, but we never say what the Word says about being healed.
Amen.
Folks, that's for me. I'm not here to say anybody. I know healing and pastors preached on healing. But I know this man had got his eyes set upon even the pool. But it was time for the eyes to be upon Jesus. It was time for the eyes to be upon the Word. And no matter what we're going through, sometimes we want to throw it out. But he told me, he says, who are you really speaking to? Who are you saying it to? It ain't the people, because I told you my word not to take no offense. That these may come. So who is it that you're speaking to? Let me see where I'm at here. Luke 15, did I miss that, Marta?
You're on the picture now.
Which one?
Back to the picture.
Let's go back to Luke 15, 25.
Okay.
I told you I was going to mess this up. Y'all remember the parable of the lost son, and we all know that scripture, this story is so good. And before it leads up to this, this has been preached, and this is one of the greatest stories, I believe. This, you know, we know that this father had two sons, and the one wanted his inheritance, and he went out and blowed it. We've heard, you know, this story, and it's a great story. And like I said, sometimes I believe we hear things and we don't listen to them because they never get over to me. And for some reason, I think, you know, I should even think it, but they don't get owed. But Pastor, I became to go on this word right here for some reason. I don't know, maybe something to me. I'll take credit for it. It was 25, it says, now his oldest son, when he went in the field and he came and drew near the house, he heard the music and dancing. So he called one of the servants and he asked to these men, and he said to him, your brother has come, and because he received him safe and sound, your father has killed the fatted calf. But he was angry and would not go. Therefore, his father came out and pleaded with him. So he answered and he said to his father, lo, these many years I have been saying to you, I never transgressed you, your commandments at any time. And yet you never gave me a young goat that I may make merry with my friends. But as soon as the son of yours came, see, he puts blame on him, who has devoured your livelihood with harlots and killed the fatted calf for him, he said to him, son, you are always with me. See, we picture the father as God, and he's coming back to the Lord. A picture our Father saying is, I know sometimes we don't want to think ourselves as a jealous type or all that, but sometimes I sure act like a pastor. Mm-hmm. I've been serving all this time. Why? I mean, maybe y'all ain't like that, but maybe it's something in me that it was stirring up. Why are they getting all the blessings? Why they getting this and that? Come on. And he said to him, son, you are always with me, and all that I have is yours. He said, I own the cattle on 1,000 hills. He could have killed as many cattle that he wanted. And it was right that I would make merry and be glad, for your brother was dead and alive again, and was lost and found. I know some of this might not hit everybody here, but in some way, somehow, this will hit you if you begin to think about it. In some way, somehow. I know it's kindly selfish to think you wouldn't want somebody. The next verse said that, I say to you that likewise, that joy shall be in heaven over one sinner than repenteth more than 99 just persons which need no repentance. They do it in heaven. No need to get mad, because you're going to get mad in heaven.
Amen.
Just be happy. I thank God for the, and it's not just this, you know, people, it's just everything. Just be content. Pastor preached not too long ago that we need to be content with what we got. This right here could fit in everything in that. Because it's all like a jealous type. If you're not content, you want more. The son had everything his father wanted. It said that, what's the next verse? I came not to call the righteous, but the sinners for repentance. What's the one after that? And blessed is he whosoever shall not be offended in thee. You know where that scripture right there come from? It's a story of John the Baptist. If you go a little bit before that, it's the same story as you need to follow that. You think that John the Baptist, Jesus said, was the greatest disciples of them all. He got put in prison
And a couple of his disciples come to him and he says, go to Jesus or go ask if he's the one or do we look for another? You know, I know it's pretty extreme because he was in prison. You know, I know we don't get put in prison, but we still got the same situations. Ask if he's the one or the coming one. John knew. John Baptist knew. He got left out. Pastor, and he began to go through all these thoughts and hurt, and why ain't out there with him? Why ain't out there helping Jesus? My God. When we find ourselves in selfish people, sometimes we're not involved in healings. Sometimes healing don't come from us. But if we're behind it, it all works together. Mm-hmm. But you gotta have that mindset. You got to have that word because you're not against the other people. You're against the word. That's what he told me. But John the Baptist was the greatest of them all and found himself wanting that. He wanted to be out there. You know, I can understand that, but sometimes in God's purpose, in life, sometimes you get shifted out of the way. Sometimes people come in and go, it's all for God's purpose. It's all for God's glory.
Yeah.
I got to accept that. Everybody here's got to accept that. Sometimes hurt will come, and sometimes we don't want that. But we got to know that God's purpose is over us all, Pastor.
Amen.
Sometimes when Jesus had to go forth, because John the Baptist, they thought, is he the one? He didn't have nothing against him. But he told even John the Baptist was the greatest of them all. And he said, even the least or the last shall be first and the first shall be last. Don't ask me why he's like that. But he don't bother me none, Pastor. Not now. Because I know that I'm offending him when I don't. The way I picture it is, if I'm last, then I'll be able to hear the ones shouting and praising. That's the way I pictured it. Maybe that's what he was thinking. Let the ones that who endured it all begin to hear the one praising. Oh, I can hear him now. Begin to praise the Lord. I can hear him now saying, the last going in first. But I see it as a reward, Brother Rick. I see it as a reward when I see the ones that made it.
Amen.
The ones that was in sin the longest, guess what? They didn't have the joy the longest. But they made it. And I'd be so glad to hear them. And Pastor, I could just see herself back there. And I hope I am one of the last ones because I'll be shouting with my other brothers and sisters.
Yeah.
They made it, they made it. My God, they made it. Listen to them shout. Listen to them praise to God. My God, he must be great. He must be mighty because I've never heard him shout like that before. I never heard him. Matter of fact, I never seen him raise their hands. But now I can hear him from way off. Oh, man. That excites me, Brother Rick. That excites me to know that every man's going to make it. I know some people don't get excited. But, whoa, when they go into that line going in, my God, they'll begin praising and shouting because I know they won't be able to sit still. I know they won't be able to sit still, Pastor. And that excites me to know. Now I'll make fun of them because they make fun of me and running around this church. And they don't know when I went home I feel so stupid. Oh, come on, church. He'll make you run when you don't want to run. Oh, come on. Hey, I just wonder if he's got a gymnasium where they can run some laps. Now make them up. Make them up. They ain't going to be making them up. Amen. Oh, I'm excited. Praise God. Praise God. If I got to watch getting excited, I'll get lost. Oh, thank the Lord. My God, my God.
Yeah.
Praise God. Everybody praise God. Yeah. Come on. Yeah. Don't make me feel it. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Praise God. Give him the glory. Give him the glory. Yeah. Because we're spending time up in that well garden, holy fire. Praise God, praise God. My God. My goodness, brother man, I knew when I hugged you it was going to rub off. I knew. I said, I've been trying to rub off on Pastor and you end up getting it. When he went out the door, I began to hug him. I'll try you. And if I don't get off you, I'll try him. But I'll soon get it, brother. I'll try you, brother. Praise you, God. Lord God, I know that you're worthy. See, I come here worthy today because I had a cough. Have you heard me cough today? Because it's God. I said, God, it's your glory. And I speak it. And to the last minute, this cough stayed with me. But my God, will we believe his word? I didn't think I had any trouble wearing this many clothes, brother man. Oh, brother. Praise God. What we got up here next so I can get back on the track? What we got?
Yes.
Amen. Let me get focused here. Praise God. I was at the pool. I know where it was at. Well, when Jesus heals, boy, he heals everything, don't he? He heals it all. He heals it all. Amen.
Yeah.
He's healed me. My goodness. Woo!
Yeah.
Proverbs 4:20-22. If you got that. My son, give attention to my words. Incline your ear to my sayings. Do not let them depart from your eyes. Keep them in the midst of your heart, for they are life to those who find them, and health to their flesh. This word right here, will give you health.
Amen.
That's where the healing is.
Yeah.
If Jesus won't do it, then it's in this word. Because it's all the same. Praise God.
Yes.
Amen. Now I'm just now getting to where I want to be, Pastor. I'm getting to where I really wanted to be. Joshua 5:13. I'm going to go back there. This is where I want to finish at. This is where God began to show me. And the scripture said in it. And it came to pass when Joshua was by Jericho, and I want to focus on that. When Joshua was by Jericho, he began to take me back 40 years. He says, I want you to look where Joshua had been, and we went back 40 years, and we looked where Joshua was with Moses and what they was going through. Now Joshua sees Moses pass away. The Lord had took him. And now Joshua was leading the Israelites into the promised land.
Amen.
And now it's all on him. He's got to get them there, Pastor. Now he's gone, and the people, all they want to do is now they want to go back because they've lost their leader. They're begging to go back to a dead and dried up land. Now they find their way there, Pastor, and they get to the promised land. Now they're so close they can smell it. They went through the Jordan. God had separated the waters again. They went through. They was fired up and ready to go. Oh boy, they done seen a miracle. They're ready to go. They're ready to fight. Now as soon as they get through, God says circumcise them again. Slow them down, Pastor. Took the wind out of them. Now they had to sit back and wait till all of them was healed. And Joshua was like, man, you know, I'm ready to take this. Pastor, I think what got me was I was so excited And I'm still waiting. I mean, you see what God's done. And I was so excited, and I was looking up on the mountaintop, just like I was at the well yard. And all I could see was what God was going to do and what He was going to do in His promises. And I was so excited, boy, and still am. And I could see Joshua. Before he got to that place, Moses had sent 12 tribes out, and he was one of the spies to go out. And they went to spy this Jericho land where he was at now. We're in verse 13. And now those 12, you know, they said, boy, this surely is a land flowing with milk and honey. Oh, my goodness, this is going to be a land for us. And they begin to take in on the produce and looking at it. And they begin to focus on Jericho, because that's the first place they took. And they begin to look at all the giants in the land and all the mighty army. But Joshua and Caleb begin to, all they could see was what God's promise was. And when they went back, 10 out of 12 gave a negative report. And it took the wind out of everybody. Cost them all. And they said that Joshua got back and Caleb, they said, let us go. We can take this land. Let us go. But it couldn't happen. Now they had to wait for all the older ones to die off. Now the younger ones has got to come in. Even Moses. But I could picture Joshua when he went and seen. He was so excited to take this land, Pastor. He was so excited to take his promise for the Israelites. He was so excited because I pictured, you know, I looked on the internet and I just had to let the Holy Spirit picture it for me. And that's the best. And I could picture Joshua in the background looking. All we could see was the promised land because he was on the mountain. Yeah. All we could see was the promise so clear that he could take it within a snap. That's all we could see. And he came back with that positive report, just like we all do. The why was there, but he couldn't really see it because he was up on the mountaintop. All we could see was the land, and while they were so scared, that they was trembling, they knew it. It's there for the taking, but now it gets closer. And I want you to focus upon this one scripture, Pastor, and begin to speak to me. Verse 5 and 12, is it up there? It said, then the manna ceased on the day after he had eaten the produce of the land. And the children of Israel no longer had manna, but they ate of the fruit of the food of the land of Canaan that year. The manna had stopped. What would that do to you when you know do I got a statement up there? What is the manna in your life that God has provided but now has ceased? There's manna in every one of our lives. See, God provided that manna all this time throughout the journey. God rained down manna and they ate. They took it for granted. But they knew God was with them. Especially Moses and Joshua and all those, Caleb and all them, they knew that God was with them. Even though the other people, they didn't think it was nothing. They just, it'll come. But for them, it was a sign that God was with them. But Brother Kevin, now the manna has ceased. This is what I think Joshua was drawn near the wall. God, I know you was there when the manna was coming. But the manna has ceased. And now, God, I know that it's there for taking.
Amen.
But God, all I can see is the wall. All I can see now is the wild God, you know. He doesn't say what He's saying. But I know that the manna had stopped. I know that they was eating some good produce. But it wasn't like the manna raining down, knowing that God was with you. God began to show me, He said, what in your life has you know that God has provided now has stopped? While they stuff in their life that God has provided to show us and to lead us to the promised land.
Amen.
But he don't want us to rely on the men. He don't want us to rely on those things.
Come on.
I believe that's why he showed up, Pastor. He showed up at the wall. The next statement. Now your faith must believe more in the promise of God than the power of Satan to hinder it. Now it relies on the faith that Joshua has to overcome this.
Amen.
He knows now that the manna in his life has stopped, and he knows now that it's all on him because he's the leader. It's all on him. And the God began to show me some things as I'm ending here. You know, Juanita, I just can't stop thinking about, you know, and I praise God that these men and women, they're bringing, you know, their husbands and stuff are getting saved, but I just couldn't stop thinking about some husbands and wives, and, you know, when they come, you can see so clearly they're about to get saved. They're about there.
Amen.
And you get so excited, Clarence, you know it's there for the taking, but there's something that changes and you're thinking, by God, it's going the other way. Because what God has provided, they used to come to church more often. They used to do this and they used to talk about this. But now it stopped. So now what are you going to believe in? Now what are you going to believe in? God wants us to believe in His Word.
Amen.
He don't want us to believe in other things and other visions. Maybe they are coming to church more. Maybe they are speaking more, you know, they're speaking more clearly. Doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. Isaiah 59:21. And this is my covenant with them, says the Lord. My spirit will not leave them, and neither will these words I have given. They will be with your lips and on your lips of your children and your children's children forever. I, the Lord, have spoken. And I began to hear that scripture, First Lady. I couldn't help but think that right there, no matter what you see, no matter what happens,
mm-hmm.
no matter what wild goods in front of you, doesn't matter. Doesn't matter if it looks like it's going the other way. God's got His promise. He's got His Word.
Amen.
He's going to be faithful to move.
Yeah.
And He says, "You'll not your just your children's, but your children's children."
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
Yeah.
Ain't that enough to excite you? Oh, praise God. Oh, praise God. I believe God's going to move, but I believe there's some things in His church that people have stopped seeing moving. But now God has sent, and like I said, I've seen some things stop moving in my life. But He says, now it's time to believe in me. Get your eyes on me, Herbie. Get your eyes on this Word. Start obeying this Word. Don't matter if people at work is arguing, don't argue with them. Don't complain with them. Shine that light. Shine that light.
That's it.
When you know your kids need all the help they can get.
Amen.
We go to the Word no matter what's happening. Proverbs 14:26. Those who fear the Lord are secure. He will be a refuge for their children.
Yes, amen.
Amen. Amen. And Miles Stiltner, I want you to tell that woman right there, she missed her place. Because
yeah.
She spoke something. The Lord spoke something to me. Clearly, it don't matter if she's here or not. But He began to speak that scripture right there. Doesn't matter. Doesn't matter. What her kids, what it's looking like. I know there's things in their lives that, my God, you know, I've been in that situation. I know that feeling, that gut feeling. It's a sick feeling. But I know God showed me some things. Trusting the Word no matter what Satan comes at us. No matter what, this Word stand on it. 1 Corinthians 7:16. Don't your wives realize that your husbands might be saved because of you?
Amen.
And don't your husbands realize that your wives might be saved because of you? That's a statement.
Amen.
That's got a question, but I believe it's a statement. Because there's already been seen.
Yeah.
And it's,
yeah.
And it's still going to happen.
Amen.
It's still going to go on.
Amen.
And the Lord gave me this last scripture, and I tell you, Pastor, I don't know how to end these things. But it ain't nothing new. Joshua 1 and 9. He says, I want you to tell them this. Have I not commanded thee? Be strong and of good courage. Be not afraid, neither be thou dismayed. Mm-hmm. For the Lord your God is with you, thee wherever you go.
Amen.
You know, Joshua, when he got up there, he knew that, I believe he seen the manna stop and all that, and I believe that he was getting his mind and began to scan it out. He'd already scanned it out before Brother Adam. He knew what he had, but he knew he had a lot of pressure on him. And I know that he was starting to think soon. But God, before that, he reminded him that 3 or 4 times. Why would you have to remind somebody 3 or 4 times if they wasn't afraid or didn't have good courage? Well, courage or Indian Creek talk. Why would you have to tell them that? Because we all do.
Amen.
But he says, Joshua, I'm going to be wherever you go.
Amen.
And there he was. And he's me. It's ready to fight. Joshua, you put your eyes on me.
Amen. That's right.
Let me do the fighting.
Amen. Amen.
You get your eyes on me, and I'll do the fighting. You won't have to worry about it.
Amen.
What he meant by that is, he began to listen.
That's right.
What do you want me to do, Lord? And you follow what his instructions are, it's a guarantee.
Amen.
It's a guarantee. Praise God.
Amen.
Praise God. I pray that y'all enjoy this. You know, Pastor, if it's all right, I know it's 8:30 Christian Standard Time. But I wanted Brianna to sing this song, if it's all right. And if she comes, I was supposed to get her up here already, but I heard this song and it began to speak to me. I said, Lord, I don't know how to end these things. And you know, Pastor, and y'all don't think I'm, you know, it's just funny, but growing up, you know, my things was, God, I want to do, I was excited about football and other stuff, but I was excited about serving God and and I never thought I'd be up here. And, you know, I still know, I'm like Moses, I can't do this. But Brother Rick, it just excites me. And I'm like, wouldn't it be great if I just had a daughter, you know, and she would sing in the news. I actually pictured this one, Edith.
Wow.
I mean, it's a funny thing, but I don't think it's a bad thing to picture things for God.
That's right. Amen.
Because I glorify Him in everything. And I heard this song, and I said, Brandy, you think you could do this? She said, yeah, I can do that. Then, you know, it got, I said, Brandy, did you get that song? She said, no, not yet. You didn't tell me or whatever. I said, you need to get that song. You need to practice it. Because my goodness, I lost sleep. I was just trying to get in this way. She must not have took it after me, but she said, I'm going to get it. I can do it. I shouldn't speak right now, but she's going to do good. But before we lose it, I just, as I go to sit down, and you know, I was just picturing, if you hear the song, you're in need. And I don't know who's all here, but if you need salvation, that's one thing that I had in there and I forgot. Maybe he's Save the last for the best. Because salvation is the greatest name. You know, Pastor, I don't doubt that people don't know God. They know God and they know that He raised Jesus from the dead. All they have to do is confess it. But some way, somehow, that there's a wall right there. They could see it so clearly before, but now they've lost vision of it. Maybe you've here tonight and you've lost that vision. Maybe you've seen yourself saved and now it's withered away.
Amen.
You come to the right place. Because I believe God's calling you. If you're here tonight, and I don't know who's here, and I'm not searching around, but I know it was on my mind doing this, and I was actually going to put it in there, but salvation is the greatest thing, and Satan can surely put up a wall.
Amen.
Sometimes we put a wrong wall up.
Yes.
But be for him tonight, and don't be against him. And if you got a need tonight, and you need prayer for just anything, I'll pray with you. Pastor, pray. Whoever you want to pray with you, they'll pray. Listen, I know it's 8:30, and Pastor used to go to 9 o'clock. It's still Christian Standard Time. It's just going to take 5 minutes, and I want y'all to listen to these words, but I'll sit right here. If you want to pray, I'll pray with you. But listen to these words as I sit down.
Even the impossible. impossible is your reality. I need to hear you now. I need to know it's you. I'm standing on your promises. I know your words are true. You're bigger than what I see. It's you in exchange for me. Cause even the impossible is your reality. God, even the impossible is your reality. Jesus, I believe. Jesus, I believe. Help my unbelief, God. Jesus, I
She doesn't shut down, does she?
I don't think what you want.
I want that scripture back up there. He started with Philippians chapter 2, verse 13, 14, 15, or 14, 15, 16. I'm sorry. I want that back up there while she's getting the little man. Are you for us or for our adversary? That's a powerful thought. Take that thought and apply it to our everyday life. Because sometimes we don't reveal that we're for him. Sometimes it reveals we're for our adversary. I know they don't want to go there, but that's where we all end up at times. We don't.
Try.
Are you up there? No. Okay. You come. Let's go get more. You don't want me to rush you, do you? Under pressure, is you? You want me to shut up and get on? Is it up there? No, it ain't in there.
I'm waiting on the screen.
Oh, what? What happened? Screen's off. Yeah. Kendra, come here. I want to come here to bring me the baby.
That's the wrong scripture, pass on. Flip it. This is Isaiah. Look at this. This is Isaiah Copeland. That's Kendra's old boy.
Look at the Lord.
And he's up.
Holding fast the word of life. What will keep you? blameless and harmless, and without fault in the midst of the crooked and first generation. Holding fast the word of life. What will keep you from going complaining? Holding fast the word of life.
Amen.
What will keep you from doing the work of the adversary?
Amen.
Fast.
Amen.
It all comes back to what you said. It all comes back. It all comes back to the word.
Amen.
It all comes back to your final authority right here. This is your final authority right here. Not what man says, not what this denomination says or that denomination says.
Yeah.
Here's the final authority. And we hold fast the word of life.
Amen.
This is life right here. This is alive.
Amen.
This is life. If you hold fast to this, it'll bring life to your life.
Listen, child. Amen.
Hold fast to it. So it doesn't matter what. Hold fast. You hold fast to the word of life. Hold fast to it.
Amen.
Hold fast to the word of life. It'll bring you life.
Amen.
Give this man a good hand. Amen. Stay with me. Come on. Let's go. Get up. We're going to get out of here. Amen. Praise God. Good morning.